The love of God is greater far than tongue or pen could ever tell. It goes beyond the highest star and reaches to the lowest hell. The guilty pair bowed down with care. God gave his son to
school. And I want to encourage you, you know, come out at that 9 o'clock hour. And everything. We have a good time studying the Word of God. But then just a reminder of the love of God. You know, so oftentimes we forget. I'm going to deal with that here just a little bit. You know, as we get into our message, I'm going to invite you to turn over to Romans chapter 8, if you would. But if I may, I'd like to just read a couple of cards. These are from a couple of the pastors that were here during our refresh. Everything. So I'm going to read, first of all, this is from Pastor Ward. And he says, "Dear church family of Shenandoah Valley Baptist Church, I simply wanted to express my appreciation for being able to preach God's Word and fellowship with you in your recent services designed to refresh. You were certainly an encouragement to me, and I trust that the truths of God's Word that I was able to share from Titus 2 refreshed your spirits to keep you going forward for God. Truly, God's grace challenges us to keep looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Thanks to all who contributed to the love offering, although it was certainly not expected, you certainly exhibit the generosity portrayed by God's people throughout the Scriptures. Be assured that I have you all in my prayers. Keep looking up." That's from Pastor Ward, First Baptist. And then Brother Brewer, Johnny Brewer, said this, "Dear Pastor in Shenandoah Valley, thank you for allowing me to have the opportunity to preach at Refresh Gathering. It was truly a blessing to be with you. Thank you all for the love offering. Praying God will continue to use you to fulfill the Great Commission." And that's Pastor Brewer. And also, I just wanted to read those before he lets you know that, you know, we brought them in to be a blessing and a refreshing to us, and it turned around, we were a blessing and refreshing to them. And also, praise God for that, amen? No, we want to keep that going. Romans chapter 8, dealt a little bit last week with verse 28. We're going to jump off of that and finish out the chapter here in just a moment. But in verse 28, and all those first words, it says, "And we know." And we know. Now, in order to know something, there has to be information out there. There has to be something that was relayed in order for us to say, "I know." And of course, what Paul is dealing with here, and all, he says, we know that all things work together for good to them who love God. And certainly the Old Testament scriptures show how God worked in and through His people. How in many times when it seems like the odds were stacked against them, God just brought good. God brought some wonderful things. God did some wonderful things through His people. So by looking back at that, we have that information and all that we can say, we know, okay? There are some things we know. And Paul's going to deal with a couple of other things that we can know in the latter part of Romans chapter 8. This is kind of titled God's Everlasting Love. God's Everlasting Love. That song that the Gaithers sang there, and I think, is one that goes way back. And I'm sure many of us remember. And, you know, even as beautiful as that song is in defining and describing the love of God, candle can't hold to it. What God's love is truly like. There's no way you and I, from a human perspective, can even begin to comprehend the reality of God's love. You know, that God so loved this world that He was willing to give His Son that you and I might come to a saving knowledge of Him. You know, when we look at this, my mind always goes back. I've told you before, I relate a lot of things to sports. I relate a lot of things to song also. Some of us can remember, what was that song, What the World Needs Now is Love, Sweet Love. You remember that one? Back there, I can't remember. I want to see Dionne Warwick, but I'm not sure she was the one that sang that. But that was a song that was very popular back in the 60s and all. And then I think it was the Bee Gees and everything that sang a song, All You Need, the Beatles sang All You Need Is Love. You remember that one? And all, and the Bee Gees had one too, something about love makes the world go round. You know, so we heard a lot of songs about love. You know, there was great movies that came out, Love Story came out, and other ones like that. You know, we can remember that. We watched particular shows that showed love of families together, you know, and how families would be. But now we look at our generation today. We look at the era that we are now in. And it seems like love is almost a bygone word. We hear it often, but yet our society very seldom reflects it. Very seldom reflects it. We look at our culture today, and all, and we see cities burning. We see businesses being robbed, looted. We see people being drug out of their cars and beaten simply because they don't agree with whatever a mindset is going on, whatever the narrative is at that time. We live in a nation today, and where over a million unborn children and everything are put to death just simply because they call it a choice. And now, even in some states, when an abortion is botched and all, they can lay that baby to the side and just let it die. You know, and we think, you know, love, you know, where's love in this thing? Where's love in our culture today? And then just the violence that we see. You know, the games that I grew up on. The games that I grew up, video games. How many of y'all ever had one of the old Atari sets? You remember that? Paul's hand went up. Had the old Atari set, you know. And, man, I grew up on Pong. Did you have Pong? Everything? Had Pong, just that little thing going back and forth, you know, is all it was. Or you go to the arcade, and there was Pac-Man. You know, y'all remember Pac-Man? You know, I mean, these were the games I grew up on, and now you look at some of these video games and there's death and destruction and war and one thing after another going like that. And is it any wonder that we see even children going out and taking the lives of others and everything, because what has their mind been fed with, you know, at what we would call a innocent video game, you know? And so, you know, we wonder, you know, where is God, where is love, you know, in this? Well, the Bible declares God's everlasting love. And I want to look at three phrases that are going to be in this portion of Scripture. And I want to tie it in with, we know. We know, okay? We know what I'm going to go to. But one of those is going to be more of a question, all right? So follow along with me. If you look in verse 31 of Romans chapter 8, you see that phrase there, that if God be for us, who can be against us? That's a great one, isn't it? I mean, we tell you, if God be for us, then who can be against us? Because after all, we know that God is above all. Amen? Let's try that again. We know that God is above all. Amen? Okay, we say that. We say that we know that, and we know that. Why? Because the Bible says that God is creator. Okay? That He sits above the heavens and the earth. That God is above all and that God is over all. We know that because His Word has declared that. But you know, there's a word there that I think a lot of times we overlook. And it's just a little two-letter word. And it's right there at the beginning of that phrase that says, if. If God be for us. Now, is there ever a time that God is not for His people? I don't believe so. I don't believe so. But let me ask this question. Is there ever a time when God's people are not for God? There is, isn't there? We look back in the Old Covenant, and we see that when Israel was obedient to the purpose of God and was obedient to the Word of God and the laws of God and everything, then the hand of God was upon them. God's hand of protection was upon them. God's hand of blessing was upon them. God's hand of mercy was upon them. God's hand of love and all was upon them. However, when they chose to disobey and not do as God instructs, then you know what? God's hand's removed. And we see the difficulty that they come on. And folks, you know, here's the thing about it. You say, well, Pastor, that's Old Testament. What in the world are we going back to the Old Testament for? That's thousands of years ago. Why are we looking at things back then? Here's the reason we look at things back then. Because number one, God has never changed. Number two, man hasn't changed. God is still God. Man is still man. Okay? And so when we look at that phrase, it's really easy to say, man, God's for us. This is going to be great. Who can be against us? But now we got to look at the word if and make a determination here. Are we for God? Are we for God? In our individual life, in our corporate life as a church, are we for God? Because listen, I tell you, so what I see in churches, And I talked to a pastor friend of mine this last week. We spent well over an hour on the phone. And it was something to hear him. Basically, he started to vent a little bit. And he said, "Don, I'm sorry." He said, "You called me for, and here I am venting." And I said, "I don't care. You go ahead. You need to do that. You need to do that." But what we see, and it just tears our hearts up so much and everything, is we see the people of God and everything start to fall away. We see the people of God start to be comfortable. We see the people of God start to be, you know, what's the word I'm looking, almost kind of like a whatever attitude. You know, man, we're willing to come on Sunday morning, you know. I mean, if nothing else comes up, we'll be here on Sunday morning. And all, but other than that, man, this is my life. I've got things to do, you know. And, you know, here's the thing about, you know, and this is what, I'll tell you, you know, even after, man, 40-some years of preaching the Word of God, I'm still learning. I'm still grasping some things. And one of the things is about salvation, you know. I think a lot of times we look at salvation and we say, yes, I am saved, you know. Man, my ticket is punched and everything. I don't have to worry about hell. And that's true. If we are born again child of God, that our name's in the book of life, and we know that when He toots, I'm going to scoot. Amen. We've got a home in heaven waiting for us. But here's the thing. Salvation is just not a ticket from hell. Salvation is an opportunity to witness and to serve and to be part of God's family. In other words, salvation is not, I'm saved, now I can do what I want with my life. No. Man, I am a child of God. Guess what? I'm His. You know why? Because He bought me. Now, what is His purpose for me? You see, God has a purpose for each one of us. But too often, folks, we become all wrapped up in what's going on in our world today. Let me tell you, what's going on in our world today is nothing short of scary. I'm just going to be honest with you. You know, I think we're in for one of the most contentious elections that this country's ever seen. You know, I work the polls. I see when people come in. Everything. It's going to be real interesting what's going to go on around the polls today. Maybe in West Virginia, I don't have to worry about it a lot. But there's places, you know, it's going to be different. And if we were just to strictly look at that, and everything. Let me tell you something, and everything, it'd drive you to drink. That's the only way to put it. You know, hate to be secular on that, but that's exactly, it just drive you to drink. But here's the thing. Is God for His people? Absolutely. Then you know what? Who can be against us? Who can be against us? And the thing about it here, folks, that includes maybe the authorities walking in and saying, we can't meet. That may be the authorities coming along your door and saying, give us your Bibles. That may be the authorities saying, and everything, that I have to submit my messages and everything and get them okayed if I can speak them to you. That may be the authorities shutting us down on live stream and stuff like that and everything because we dare preach the Word of God, and that's not going to be powerful today. We may even have to come to the point of where, are we willing to spend a little jail time? You say, Pastor, that can never happen in America. Are you serious? Honey, it's happening. It's happening. And it may just get a little bit worse. But here's what. We know that if God is for us, if God is for His church, if God is for His word, who can be against us? The question you have to ask is, am I for God? Am I for God? The second thing I want you to look at that we can know is found in verse 37. He says, we know that we are more than conquerors through Him who loved us. Now, we understand the word conquer, right? You know, we understand, we can go back in the history books, we can go back to World War II, and we see where the Allies, everything which we were part of, where the Allies conquered the Axis powers of Germany and Italy in World War II and Europe. And then also the same Allies conquered the Empire of Japan in the Pacific in World War II. So we understand conquer. But here's the thing. We're not talking about a physical battle there. The Bible talks about we were in a spiritual battle, isn't it? We dealt with this with our men and all yesterday. We are in a spiritual battle. This is a supernatural thing going on. This is a battle, and I hate to sound simplistic of it, but it is exactly true. This is a battle of good and evil, light and darkness. There's no other way around it, okay? And we're right in the midst of that battle. You know why? Because we have an adversary, the devil, who walks about as a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. So here the Bible says, you know what? We can know that we are more than conquerors. Why? Because we've seen God bring victory after victory after victory after victory to his people all through the Word of God, haven't we? And there's probably been even victories in your life and everything. You sit back and say, man, this is a God thing, that God brought this. And so while we may not be fighting those with knives, guns, swords, and helmets, we know that there are things that we are battling, that we do struggle with. You know, I think things like fearful. God said he doesn't give us a spirit of fear, does he? But he gives us one of love, of power, and a sound mind. We can conquer that fear. How? And how do we conquer those things? Well, look there. We are more than conquerors through him, through Christ, who loves us. See, my victory is not in myself. My victory is not in my education. My victory is not in ability. My victory and your victory is in Christ, you see. He's the one that is over all. He's the one that if he is for us, then we have not to worry about those who would be against us. More than conquerors, there's fear, there's doubt. Okay? There's doubt, there's anxiety. And yet the Bible tells us, don't be anxious about things. Don't be anxious about things. You doubt. Doubt's the opposite of faith, isn't it? We're supposed to live by faith without doubting, the Bible says. Look, I struggle just like you do. Please don't think that because I'm up here Sunday after Sunday that I've got my act together. Let me tell you something. It's a day by day by day by day walk. But we know that we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. We know that. Because God's Word lays that out. God's Word gives us that example. God's Word shows us that thing. So regardless of what we may face, we are more than conquerors because in Christ we can overcome it. And we can overcome. We overcome through His Word. We overcome through the fellowship of one another. We overcome through hearing the Word of God. We overcome through songs. That song that we did today, that last one about worship. How timely that was since we spoke about that in Sunday school, you see. And we worship when we put him above all things. Above all things. Why do you think the Bible says looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith? Why do you think the Bible says seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness? And then all these things will be added unto you. So we know that we are more than conquerors. We know that if God is for us, who can be against us? And then here's the last one. Now I want to share with you what Paul is talking about here and then have a question. All right? In verse 38, Paul says, "For I am persuaded." Paul is saying, "I am firmly convinced about this matter, that neither death nor life, neither angels or principalities or powers," and that's talking about the spiritual struggles, "nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing." So Paul is summing this up. He says, "I am persuaded that there is nothing in creation that can separate me from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord." Paul said he was persuaded of that. And you know what? I guarantee you, I'll bet you every one of us in here, we're persuaded of that. We're persuaded that our salvation is fully in Jesus Christ. We are persuaded that heaven is our eternal home. We are persuaded that our name is in the Lamb's Book of Life. We are persuaded that when the Lord comes back, I am going to be going. We are persuaded. Why? Because the Word of God tells us that. Amen? Isn't that why we are persuaded? And all because the Word of God tells us Christ is coming back for us and everything. The trumpet is going to sound, the last shout and everything. We're going to be with Him. We know that because of the persuasion of God's Word. But here's the question. Are we persuaded that God can still use me? Are we still persuaded that this church is to be a light on this hill? Are we still persuaded that as long as we are here, we are to live for Him? Are we persuaded of that? Are we convinced of that? Because, folks, if not, then there's no sense us being here. There's not enough. There's just not enough of us to see this any other way. We are here together. For whatever reason, God has put us together. We are here together to be a light and to be His light. I don't want us to look at this and say, man, I hope we can get back to what we were in the 80s. We'll never be what you were in the 80s. It's not going to happen. Boy, I hope that we can get everything repaired like we need to get repaired. Okay, that's a good goal, but you know what? What if it doesn't happen? Do we give up? Do we quit? Or are we persuaded that God still has a purpose for the light to shine from this hill? But the only way the light can shine from this hill is that each one of us has to be persuaded that I still have a purpose and that God can use me. Maybe He can't use you like He used to, and that's okay. But are you willing to be used like He can use you? Maybe knock doors off, which I'd be afraid to anyway. You'd get shot. But you know what? You can offer a track to somebody, can't you? Maybe you can't take your Bible and sit down with somebody and show them what they need to do. But you can ask your waitress when you go out to dinner or something, ask how you pray for her. Begin to share God's love that way. Folks, all we have to do is just be available. Be available for whatever the moment is. Be available in any way. I'm so grateful Barry came in all smiles this morning. Because we've been pleading. And right now, the only children's ministry outreach we have in our community is our Awana. And he was needing help because you know what? Awana's is growing. There's kids that are inviting kids. The little Spanish kids up there, they're going to town, man. They're working on this thing. They're inviting their friends coming in. We got to have some help. And you've heard him over the weeks. We've got to have some help. We've got to have some help. Well, guess what? Help arrived. There are some folks from here that showed up. I think you said, Barry, there's folks from another church that showed up too, wasn't there? You know what I'd love to hear one day? I'd love to hear Barry come with the Awanas. I'd love to hear Barry come and say, Pastor, we've got too many people back there working, you know, so can we find something else for them to do and everything? They're just bumping into each other. We got so many people back there. Wouldn't that be cool if that were to happen? Hey, you know, that happened in the Scripture one time, you remember? You know, I think it was the building of the tabernacle, if I'm not mistaken. Everything, they asked the people, say, hey, start bringing stuff. And finally, they came to Moses and said, tell them to stop. We got more than we need. We don't know what we're going to do with it all. That's never been a problem in Baptist Church. Okay? I would love for Daryl to get up some Sunday morning and say, hey, you know what, folks? We don't need offerings for the rest of the year. We're good. Wouldn't that be cool? Daryl love it. He's smiling back there. Make that announcement. You know. But this is just what we're talking about. Are you available and are you persuaded that God's still got something for you to do? You see, are you persuaded? So see, there's things that we know in the Word of God. But the question is, do we believe it? Do we believe if God's for us, who can be against us? Do we believe? Are we for God? Are we for Him? That's the question. Do we believe that we are more than conquerors through Him who loved us? The question is, do you believe that? And then we know that from the Word of God, we're persuaded, because the Word of God tells us so, that nothing in creation can separate us from God's love. Are you persuaded that God still has something for you to do? And that God still has a reason for this church to be here? The question you got to ask this morning, are you available or needed? Are you available or needed? Let's bow our heads if you would, please. Heads bowed and eyes closed.